So there's no real introduction here. So this is a conversation amongst us, and then we'll open up some time for questions at the end. And you really are the true believers because you've cut your lunch short to come and listen to us. So thank you for that. So what we'll do is we'll briefly introduce ourselves, and then we've got some topics that we want to share with you based on our experience. And so to start off with, I'm Christopher Richins. I'm the CEO and co-founder of RBC Signals. And RBC Signals provides communication infrastructure as a service, ground infrastructure, to be able to communicate with low Earth orbiting satellites. So as your satellites are in orbit, you need to get data down. We provide that ground infrastructure so you don't have to build a global network of ground stations yourselves. To give a little bit of background on my history and some of the perspectives that I'll bring to the Fireside conversation today, I actually started as a business person and became an engineer so that I could be a better business person. I was completely smitten, or I guess bitten by the space bug back in 1998 when I heard about this company Sea Launch that would take Russian and Ukrainian rockets, put them on Norwegian ships, go to America to be integrated together, and then they would sail down to the ocean and launch huge satellites into space. And so I wanted to run a multinational space company like that. And so I called them up on the phone and asked them what I needed to do to work there, and they said they needed communication engineers. So I said, okay, that works. And so I changed my major from business to engineering, and it took 3.5 extra years, but it was worth it. And so I have a launch experience, worked at Sea Launch for 5 years, and then also I've worked at places like SpaceX. I was an early employee at Planetary Resources, employee number 3 there, and so early stage hardware companies. And then I've also been a business consultant and obviously now a founder of a small company. So I bring those perspectives to our conversation today and look forward to hopefully sharing some ideas that will be valuable and also putting some new ideas into your heads on things that you should be aware of.
Okay, my name is Tom. I'm one of the founders of Berlin Space Technologies. So we are here based out of Berlin, and we're building small satellites in the range of 50 to say 150 kilograms. And so you might know that Berlin is quite a hub for small satellite technologies. So since more than 30 years, the guys here in the region built these type of stuff. So they really pioneered a lot of the technology. To be honest, the whole region has never been so sophisticated in making actually the business transition. So what you brought up is actually a very important thing, that it's not only about the technology but also about the business. But fortunately, with events like this Rust Space, Berlin is also put on the map for real commercialization. So what we are seeing from us as a company, so we are basically vertically integrated. That means we build most of the stuff in-house, along the same lines like SSTL was many years ago, but very similar background, university founded, and a lot of tech entrepreneurs, and then figuring out, okay, what are we going to do with the satellites, right? And we are now at the edge where basically the satellite, the single satellite, is not that much of a deal anymore. It moves really towards the application. That's why we have a lot of application people approaching us, say, hey, hi Tom, how can you help us? And in the past it was always like, hey, how we can build one satellite, and now it's more like, how can you build 100 or 500 or 1,000? And so for us it's now really customer driven towards how can we build that? Like, how can we basically have a factory and be able to do and build things relatively quickly? And that is where we come into the discussion here today, and I hope I can contribute to the things. And then obviously I give over to Luca, who is in the business of getting rid of the stuff that we are putting up there. So,
Hi everybody, Luca Rossettini, I'm the CEO of The Orbit. Yes, so we get rid of satellites basically. And well, I was at NASA in 2010 and I was talking with this guy in charge of space debris analysis and mitigations, and I was basically stalking the guy, and eventually said, Luca, you know, we know space debris, we know very well, we study space debris since the 70s, you know, don't worry, the space is big. And so I said, wow, if the conception is that the space is big while we are using only a small part of space, only highways in space, and we cannot afford to leave our cars in the highway and buy a new car just because we are out of fuel or just because we break down our cars. So why should we do it in space? So I came back to Europe and found the orbit in 2011. So what we start doing at the beginning is the commissioning system to remove satellites at the end of life. In a more efficient way than using the onboard propellant, so it's cheaper and more convenient. And also when the satellite is dead, so we want really to cover the world scenarios. And then we start talking with big players, big satellite integrators, big satellite operators, dealing with their strong and requirements, reliability issues, and safety issues, and so on. But then we saw what was going on. So large constellations, small satellites. And if I ask to you guys that you are building constellations, if you ever think about decommissioning your satellites, if you have CubeSat, you probably are not thinking about removing CubeSats. Well, you know, in less than a year, they will be gone anyway. Or if you are building constellation of 100 kilogram, 150 kilogram satellites, and you are still at the beginning of the designing phase, you are not really thinking at the end of life. So we said, okay, how can we give value? And the value is not removing the satellites, to give you more revenues, more time in orbit, better precision in orbit. This is what we do now for small satellites. And of course, at the end of life, you can remove your satellite as well. This is the orbit today.
Okay. So the question that we are always asked, like, why are we doing these things, right? So, and one thing that I've learned over the last few years is that if you can avoid it, you shouldn't do things with space, because it's horrendously expensive, and it's very difficult, and it's very challenging. And the thing that I always see is that in the space business and on these conferences as well, there are always too many space engineers, even if they're doing applications, right? I brought yesterday the example of everybody want to build their own stuff because it's cool, but eventually it will bite you, because if you have not checked your background from the beginning, can your application be done by any means other than space? Then these guys will bite you, because they have always a cost advantage over you. And once you have figured out that space is actually the least best option to solve any problem, right, and you figured out, okay, you have to use that least best option, once you are in this state of mind to think, okay, I have to use space because there's no other way around it, make sure that is. And then you still have to think, okay, what are the things that I'm going to do? Is it about fancy technologies, or is it about getting things done? And a lot of things that people don't think about a lot of times is the communication, right? How do you get the data down, right? If you have a very small spacecraft, it might not cost much, but the amount of data drives your business model. That is your business case, right? And so it is helpful to start the communication, the process of how to go for these things very early on, right?
Yeah, so let me talk a little bit about the revenue side as well before I jump into communication. And actually, even before the revenue side, I love the point that you made about you go to space as a last resort, because I think that there are a lot of ways to solve your customers' problems. And I wanted to bring up an example from a company that I admire, a new space startup called Ursa Space, that was planning on building a constellation of SAR spacecraft, synthetic aperture radar, to be able to take pictures through clouds and at night. And they knew that there was a need in the marketplace, and so they started this plan to design these satellites. But rather than wait until the satellites were in orbit to start planning what to do with their data, they started going out and talking to their customers. And not just talking to their customers, but they started building the platform, and they actually bought data from all of their competitor spacecraft that were already in orbit. And what they ended up finding out was that there was a lot of value in doing those data analytics and in the new ways they were thinking about it. And before much time had passed, they realized they didn't need to build satellites at all. And I think that's brilliant, is that they realized that, and in a lot of these cases, talking to your customers first and understanding what the business is that you're trying to solve, looking at terrestrial options as a way to solve it, or looking for substitute options, doing everything you can, and then if and only if space is the last potential option for you. Then you talk about, okay, how do we do that? And then once you start thinking, okay, we need to send something to space, what we want to do is we want to bring up some of the ideas about things that you should be aware of while you're planning your space constellation. Communication is one of those things. And it's communication is just one of the pieces of the entire puzzle. And my strong recommendation is that you take a systems engineering approach to how you plan your constellation ahead of time. Rather than focusing on just that one technological niche or that special thing that you and your company are going to do, you need to really look broadly at how are you going to deliver that service for your customer end to end. Because it's not just about that new sensor that you're building, it's about the entire process. How are you going to get licensed? How are you going to launch? How are you going to operate those satellites once they're in space? How are you going to bring that data from space down to the ground? And when you look at things, don't just try and optimize just for, oh, we need to get the spacecraft as cheap as possible, and then, because other costs can pop up in other places. You want to take a systems engineering approach and look at lifetime mission costs for delivering that information to your customer as you evaluate your different options, because the further you get down the path of designing your constellation or your spacecraft, the fewer degrees of freedom or the less flexibility you have to make other decisions. And so if you can make a good system engineering approach to designing the entire architecture from beginning to end at the beginning, you're going to have a much better solution at the end, and then you're not going to get stuck making very, very expensive decisions much later on in the process.
Yeah, I would add also another issue that, as I said at the beginning, you may not think about at the beginning, but it's very important at the end. And if you don't take into consideration that the cost is of the whole mission, and including the operations and the end of life, then you ended up spending more money. I tell you the story of a very well-known constellation that's on the newspaper basically every week, okay? Especially last week. so you know what I'm talking about. So they started thinking that they don't need to remove their satellites because they were operating small satellites. 150 kilogram satellites can, you know, be removed in like 25 years, maybe. And then they start facing an issue of, okay, but we are using electric propulsion. So if we start losing our satellite, then we have to go for collision avoidance maneuvers. And usually operators today perform collision avoidance maneuvers, including these collision avoidance maneuvers within their maintenance of the satellite. So they are not really wasting fuel, not as much as at least. But when you have a constellation with several planes, several satellites in each plane, then you start thinking, okay, but I'm losing connection time. If you start losing one satellite, well, yeah, I can manage. If you start losing three satellites, I can manage. But what is the overall reliability of a satellite today at the end of life? If you check, the average is below 90%. So it means that if you have, let's say, 1,000 satellites, 100 will stay there. And then your business case is not closing. So this constellation decided, okay, we need to do something. And now they are able to, according to their plan, to remove their satellites in less than 5 years from 1,200 kilometers. And if you know about mission analysis, you know what it takes to remove a satellite from 1,200 kilometers in less than 5 years. But it's not enough. They increase their reliability up to 95%. Maybe there is like big companies here that can say the contrary, but I think it's one of the highest possible today. But still, 5% of those satellites will stay there. So now they are looking for orbit clearance solutions. They have to move away that satellite from the orbit anyway. And they are counting that in the future, someone else will go and grab those satellites and bring them away. Otherwise, they can't run their business. If they spend a lot of money doing that, of course, and for you guys, so keep in mind that every single piece is part of your cost. It's impacting your business on a recurrent point of view. So plan advance, take into account, maybe you don't have to think today to a solution. There are a bunch of companies around the world providing solutions for this, but keep in mind that sooner or later we have to to think about. Even when you are filing the frequency license, you need to demonstrate that you will be able to remove the satellites at the end of life, among many other things. So keep in mind that whatever you know today, it's a saving for tomorrow.
Yeah. So I would jump to into that idea of the savings, right? So one I was discussing with some customers, and they were telling me, well, we have this idea of having a new constellation, and we want to do this and that, and we obviously, you know, we're raising some money, and we need to bring things up there. And then I said, okay, now how are we going to demonstrate our, you know, minimum viable product, right? And the usual idea was to build their own satellites. So first they said, okay, need to take a big satellite, or then they want to take a CubeSat, and then they figured out, well, regardless of what they do, they pay through the nose, because they, especially if they want to commit to a launch agreement, then they have to usually pay 24 months in advance. And if you want to do things really, really quickly, you're usually putting the stuff on the launch pad maybe 8 months before the launch. And so at a very early stage, you cannot really afford to have high money siphoning out, and still you have to maybe buy a big launch or a small launch and a satellite and so on. And so we are getting a lot more attention to this thing, and I think Luca, you're also doing the similar things like we do. We are offering basically the opportunity to host it, to host payloads on our satellites, right? So usually we have some real estate on the satellites, and the people can put some things on there. Sometimes we build a dedicated platform. Luca, you build platforms that bring up CubeSats, as far as I know. But that is something that you can also think about. It's like, okay, even after I figured out I actually want to be the one that builds things, even though my business might be somewhere else, then consider maybe not to build the whole thing. Try to concentrate. You know, if your core IP and is in a sensor, why should you reinvent the wheel in building a new satellite? There are literally hundreds of companies out there who can help you with that. You might not even need a full satellite. You can put it somewhere. There are hosted payload opportunities once in a while. And it's always in a matter of, okay, how can I get down the cost? Because if you buy a CubeSat, you'll spend between $500,000 and $1 million, and the hosted payload opportunity might start at $200,000. So for the same amount or more of performance. Yeah, so that's the things that should be kept in mind. Yeah.
Yeah, I really agree that leveraging the other people's investment is critical. Yeah. There are hundreds of millions of dollars being invested in space technologies. Why in the world would you want to reinvest your own capital into things that are being built by other people and is their area of expertise, where they've got engineers that have spent their lives passionate about this project doing something? Like, if I need to deorbit something, I'm going to Luca because they know it better than anybody in the world. Communications, hopefully you'll come to companies like RBC Signals, and there are others out there, but you don't need to create those architectures by yourself. If you need a bus, there are options out there. So really leveraging those investments is critical. And if I was an investor in your company, you would have some explaining to do if you were telling me that you were going to be building your own bus or doing your own system integration. It just, there has to be a compelling reason why you do that. If I can take just a second, I know this may be basic for most of you here, but I just want to talk a little bit about some of the challenges from a communication perspective relative to a constellation, because I am constantly surprised by the customers who I get to talk to on a regular basis who are not prepared or don't have a concept of what is required for low Earth orbit communications. And so first of all, just really quickly, a satellite in a low Earth orbit, if we just in general terms, will orbit the Earth about every 90 minutes. And line of sight is still required to be able to communicate with the satellite. Until we learn how to string fiber optic cables or something to an orbiting spacecraft, you require line of sight. And so that means you either need to have a satellite in a higher orbit that can look down and have visibility, or you need to have a station on the ground that can look up and see your grounds, see your spacecraft from the ground. If you are trying to move a lot of data if you have a sensor that is generating hyperspectral data or SAR data or any kind of anything that's generating a lot of data that you need to downlink to the ground, think about how long it's going to take at the data rates that you're liable to be able to operate at to get that data down. And that will tell you how many minutes a day of communication time that you need. And you'll start to realize that if a satellite goes from horizon to horizon in less than 10 minutes, you may require multiple ground stations to be able to get the volume of data that you need down. The other thing that drives multiple ground stations is if you require low latency. While it's true that if you're in a sun-synchronous orbit and you have one polar ground station, you can see your satellite maybe once in orbit, so once every 90 minutes. For some of your applications, that is not enough to meet the demand of your customers. And so you're going to require ground stations spread across many places in the planet to be able to keep your latencies low. And so rather than building your own ground station networks, leverage the ground station networks that are out there. But you need to be thinking about these things ahead of time, because if you have in your mind that you're going to use a network of ground stations, your whole system architecture can change. The size of the radio can change, the types of batteries that you're flying can change. There are a lot of things. And then also how you go after your spectrum licenses can change, and your ITU filings. All of these things you need to be doing up front. Communication and the architecture that you use will have a significant impact on all of those areas. And so go out, get good advice, and don't wait until you're 6 months to launch before you start thinking about how you're going to move data from space to the ground.
Yeah, I can definitely, cannot stress that enough, right? Because the last mission that we did was a hyperspectral mission, and you usually have some bottlenecks in your mission, and for hyperspectral it's always data to the ground, right? In some missions it's power, and then you can deploy more solar panels, but with this mission is like you have a data rate internally of 2 gigabit per second, and then you have a very fast 100 megabit. Very fast for a microsatellite, 100 megabit downlink, and it means that 1 second of image taking takes you close to half a minute with all the overheads to get the data down. And if you have only one ground station, then you take one image and you download for 3 days. So if that is a business case, then probably you need somebody who pays a lot for that one image. And if your satellite has capabilities to basically be able to download more images because it has the power, then increase of maybe one image instead of from one image you can do 5 images per day, you basically have increased your commercial viability 5 times. And there's a lot of small things that you can do that will reduce the cost much more drastically than all the little tinkering. So one of my professors at university says there are a couple of important rules in physics and in building satellites, and you have the conservation of momentum and all these rules, and he said, but the most important one is the conservation of problems. The number of problems that you face in a project will always be the same, right? If you have a type of problem, the type of problem to solve that is the same. If you solve it this way, you will have problems there, and if you have solved it that way, you have problems there. And the only thing that you can really do is to try to push it into a direction where you have hopefully some tools to solve the problem, right? And then. If you have a bottleneck, you could either make a 5 times faster transmitter, which might cost you 100 times more because you might go to laser, and laser these days costs, I don't know how many, 100,000s, or you could also go for more ground stations. The same is true if you want to launch things, right? You can always go with dedicated launches and so on, or you could go to Luca and say, okay, we go with a less than desirable orbit, it's a wrong orbit height, but the same inclination, and somehow we get to that orbit, right? And then Luca can provide you with a solution, right? So that is more the system approach of it.
Yeah, another issue, it's on ground, it's how you move your satellite to the launch bay, right? So if you have one satellite, that's fine. So you study the problem, you said, okay, I have to be launched by PSLV in India. And but when you have a bunch of satellites to launch, it's likely you're going to use different launchers, and timing is the most important resource that you have to deal with. Because no matter how good we are, we always ended up very late, and we have to run like a crazy, working day and night, you know, to match the milestone and also mitigate all the things that can happen, especially in the last month. So start studying what are the regulations in your country to move your satellites within the country and also outside your country. And usually are different government agency, and you can't deal with them. You can't convince them to be faster. So you have to stick with their timing, and you have to know in advance how long it takes. And we are talking about months. So if you think that you will be able to build...
Some is years,
yeah. So if you think that you will be able to build the satellite in 6 months, yes, you can do it. You can build the satellite. But if you think that you can launch from scratch a satellite in 6 months, it's really tough. For me, it's impossible, unless you already have done this process much before. So import export regulations, how you transport the system, insurance to move your stuff to the launch site. If you have propulsion on board, be aware that propulsion in some case could be considered dual use technology, and that this is actually another full range of issues that you have to face. And of course, the launch provider, there are like a bunch of launch providers, especially for small satellite brokers that can allow you to be launched, and they offer you insurance services and so on. But they arrive at a certain point, and then you have to provide them the documentation on your technology. So be aware that this may take like a full-time resource and like for several months. So be aware of this.
On the topic of regulation in general, export is a huge one that you have to pay attention to. The other are the ITU and other frequency coordination filings that need to happen. One of the challenges that we're seeing, especially as you have people imagining these larger and larger constellations, that there's a fixed amount of spectrum that has been allocated to communication services from low Earth orbit. And that spectrum can't be used at the same time in the same place, and so it needs to be shared across globally. And because we're talking about low Earth orbit, these satellites will be over many places on the globe, and so the challenge goes beyond just the regulatory challenge and getting the regulators to agree with you, but it's actually doing what you need to do to be able to do frequency coordination with the other companies around the world or countries that are going to be trying to operate in that same spectrum globally. And so that's something that you're going to need to start doing immediately. As soon as you understand what your customer requirements are and you start to think about how much data you need to move, and then that leads you to pick a frequency band, then you immediately need to start talking with the other operators and finding out who else is using that spectrum and start talking to them as early as possible. Because if you wait for the regulators to make the decision on how you're going to work, that is going to take forever, and they're likely to make the wrong decision. But if as an industry we come together, and there are groups that do this, there's the Commercial Small Sat Spectrum Management Association that is meeting together on a regular basis. The next meeting is coming up at the SmallSat conference in Logan, Utah. Get involved and start talking about the spectrum that you want to use. This is not something that you can just sweep under the rug and hope that the issue goes away. You will not be able to communicate with your spacecraft if you're not thinking about these things early.
Just a quick note on regulations, but this time on towards space. Also, be aware the regulations are changing. We are living in a transient phase for space. So we know what is valid today, but we don't know what will happen tomorrow. We are creating like the commercial, like a strong commercial aspect of space. Someone has created the space market, and now we are changing. So start thinking what could be the regulation or what could be the cost that we are facing in 5 years or like 7 years. Because if it takes a couple of years, 3 years to build your company, it's likely that your constellation will be operationally like in 4 to 5 years. And then the situation may be completely different from what it is today. Like I'm in the space debris field, even CubeSat are facing problems, or even the 25 years rule is under discussion now. Because who's going to pay the monitoring of commercial companies? So I pay like a waste tax in my country, and you pay a waste tax in your country. So they are discussing how to charge private companies that actually leave waste in space. And this could be a cost that actually is just highly impacting your recurrent revenue. So think in advance of what could be. I mean, space debris is one topic, but it's probably the smallest one at the moment. But there will be many others.
Yeah. So coming back to the regulation, what you need to be aware of is that the regulation is different from country to country. It's not that we have one big global regulation, and you have some things that are similar, like the ITU filings. You know, you have to go through that central body, but some countries, you know, they make it mandatory if you have public money in there for some source, you have to comply with the 25-year rule, and they make it they make you comply with other rules. In some countries, you have to provide insurance. Like I think in France and in the UK, you have to provide launch insurance. In Germany, you don't have. In Germany, it is at the moment, to my understanding, very nice to operate a satellite, because if your satellite crashes into somebody else, the German government will pay, and because they can't get their hands on you, right? They maybe still be doing that, but at least the law at the moment says otherwise. So there are these things that are different from country to country, and especially also with the export regulations, right? Even though we have dual use under which all satellites fall is the same in all of Europe, in some countries the export goes significantly faster than in others, right? So I know in the Netherlands, in the UK, you can usually get the export process done in maybe 3 months. In Germany, as I can tell you from own experience, it might take up to 2 years. So the question is where you are locating your manufacturing, and where you are applying for these things, and where you have your company is a very important thing, and you should, you know, talk about the business, but you should also talk about the legal aspects and try to figure out where there's a good location, and to have a location which is in favor of you and supports you, preferably near a launch location. There's not a big secret, but the OneWeb put into Florida because they want to be close to the launch pad. They don't have any export stuff because they stay in the US, you know, because otherwise getting stuff out of the US is pretty difficult. And so these things is things that you need to consider as well for the global picture.
And tax is the least of your problem today. So if you choose a location because of tax today, you are wasting your money and your time. Yeah. Well, why don't we open the floor to questions? So if you have any questions of any type of the constellation that you are building, and we are here for this.
It seems either no constellation builders or very shy ones.
You know, they told me that if we stay in silence for 8 seconds, you will feel so embarrassed, some of you will.
Hi guys. Well, thanks for all this chat, first of all. I would like to know if you could name maybe the three main constraints you have regarding putting in orbit your satellite. So is it in terms of trajectory? Is it in terms of time to orbit? Cost? You were talking about the export regulation and so on.
So in my case, I'm launching a satellite in 2 months. So it's really fresh experience, many issues. It's like to understand which are the three most important is difficult. But first of all, there's a big delay on launch, but this is common for everyone. So it's that, you know, everybody has the same problem. It's not a problem. Import-export for us was a great, great issue. because we have a propulsion system on the satellite, and it's the first of a kind. So, like, even finding the regulation that was supporting us was difficult. So there was a regulation from a certain type of satellite on, but not below. So we were in the land of no one and nowhere, and no one was take responsibility of telling us what to do. So eventually, we have to invent. Say what to do and convince the regulators to go in this direction, and it took more than a year and a very good network. Okay, so without the network, I would probably be sitting here waiting for like a piece of paper saying that I can go ahead with my. So for me, import export was one of the greatest issues.
For me, well, we have done all kinds of stunts in the past, right? So I don't know whether you've followed our Singaporean satellite, but that one literally was integrated in 3 weeks and checked out in 1 week, and then delivered to the launch pad in a mere week and put on a rocket in 2 days. A lot of the things that look very large and big and overwhelming, you can actually solve. The one thing that stopped us nearly in the track was actually the regulations again with the export, because the export approval came 2 weeks before shipment, so that was again for us a very big thing. And the other thing is that we run into is actually problems with the up and down link. So we had installed a ground station in Singapore overlooking the harbor, and for the first few months we had a lot of interference because, well, we are using non-commercial UHF bands, and a lot of the ships are also using non-commercial UHF bands, and so 4,000 ships sitting 2 kilometers away from you are for sure a lot louder than your tiny little spacecraft there, right? So that was something that we have not thought before, and for sure some solution to have ground station somewhere else could have circumvented that. That's the thing.
And I'm not flying anything, so I'll let these guys take it from there.
If I may say, this is more related to what they do, but we were called by a satellite integrator that was sending up a sort of prototype for a constellation, and I can give you more details, but the story is more important in this case. And he met his customers, and the customer said, this is not good because your satellite is single string, and you can't ensure the end of life, so you can't apply for the frequency license because you are not demonstrating that, blah blah blah. So they contacted us on Friday, and for Monday we have to submit the offer and so on. So of course we have to do it, right? So we cannot afford to lose this opportunity, but it was much more a pain for our potential customers than for us, because they worked like the last 2 years on that. So this is sometimes you face this situation. So it was not my issue, it was the issue of someone else. But when you have very tight schedule, and you face problems that you should have faced like months before or years before, then it's crazy, and you have really to use all your blood to make it anyway.
Some of the highest risk objects in space now are old Russian upper stages in 800 to 1,000 kilometer high inclination orbits. What can be done to try and solve the previous problems, because if those explode or collide, there'll be, you know, more generations of shrapnel in very valuable real estate.
Maybe I can say something about that. There is a problem. There are these objects. There are many of that. There are also small fragments, and the sky is full of debris. The real issue is, I think it's not a matter of technology. Of course, we will need maybe
you know, like fine-tune technology to do that. But who's paying for that? If there is no market, no companies are going there. There are a bunch of companies that actually wanted to go for active debris removal. I know very well a company that is based between Singapore and Japan, and now they are changed their business because they need to make money to survive, right? So they found another good business and they are into that. There is no market for active debris removal today. There may be a market tomorrow associated to large constellations. And then when you have like a market, then you can also do something like that. There is the European Space Agency is investing billions on a mission that is called ED Orbit. And it's mainly devoted to remove Envisat. Because it's a very bad, bad situation for like the European Space Agency reputation. But that technology may be used, but how many years do we need to see it in place? So I think it's an issue. The technology may be already available, but the market is not there.
Yeah, this I can totally agree to it. So a lot of the space situational awareness and the orbit stuff in Europe is, I was told, mainly because Envisat is the biggest risk on all the risk collision risks. So if you can remove that, then Europe is not anymore in the front. So then maybe the European effort to remove stuff is going lower. But yeah, I totally agree with Luca. So it's at the moment where you have the problem of a unmanaged resource. Space is an unmanaged resource. It doesn't belong to anybody. It belongs to everybody. And it's the same with the water in California or in everywhere else, right? So you know, why should you go nicely with your resource if anybody else is not doing that? And I think the idea to have a tax on removing the spacecraft or a fee is a very good idea, but who should implement it, right? And you have always rogue states. You have the same problem with ships, right? Most of the tonnage is in very, very small countries, which couldn't care less about environmental and other issues, and which attract huge fleets, right? And that's a issue that we are facing as well. And the problem is that space might be a little bit less forgiving than the damn huge ocean, because if there are ship things, it's on the ground and maybe pollutes a little bit locally. But if a few of the satellites of a constellation explode, this orbit is completely useless anymore for everybody. So it's a really tough thing.
Yeah, unless you provide the value to a commercial customer, then the market is not starting. So like at the beginning, I fought to solve the problem of space debris as a company, but actually was not working. Then we changed what we were doing to match what the customers actually need, right? So the customer need to get rid of all the pain, all the issues at the end of life. They don't want, you know, end of life is non-existing. They don't make money. It's just a cost. So this is the value. Otherwise, if you would want just to save the world, then you are not making money out of it.
Yeah.
You have to save the world providing value. That's, in that case, it works.
Yeah.
And with that, I'd like to thank all the panelists. I think time is a bit over for more questions, but I believe...